the Wynton Marsalis Quintet playing I've Never Been in Love Before, which is, I think, from Guys and Dolls. Wynton, come and sit down. It's not what you'd automatically think of as a jazz standard, is it?
No, not really. I've never heard it done in an instrumental version. But a lot of singers do it at home.
Maybe you know people are starting to take jazz too seriously. The critics. Well, critics are people, I suppose, aren't they?
Well, the critics, the development of the music. You know, the music passed. Once the music got into what they call the bebop era, for lack of a better term, I think because the musicians became serious about the music, the critics and the people, by and large, were not ready to accept that. And I think that we've seen that the attitude has not changed now, 40 years, 42 years later. And I think the critics are always telling people that this music is difficult to understand. Yeah. So consequently, people go out to hear the music with that in their minds. So rather than sitting out and enjoying the music for what it is, they go like they're going to a boring church meeting or something.
Yeah.
You know, when really they are a boring
speech. Or a difficult game of chess.
Right,
I mean, what if I make the wrong move?
And the thing that we are trying to get people to understand is that they are not supposed to understand music to like it.
Well, looking around the studio when you're just playing now, just big smiles on people's faces. It's fun.
It is. Great fun.
You started when you were very young. You were a child prodigy, weren't you?
No.
No? I thought you started playing the trumpet when you were six or something?
I started, but I couldn't play. You know, I didn't practice. So I was sad. I didn't really want to become a musician until I was 12 or 13, and that's too late to be a child prodigy. Then I started practicing diligently, but during my childhood, I couldn't.
No, your father was a musician.
My father.
Your brother is with you now as a musician. Right. So the whole family was involved in music, and yet you didn't take it seriously at all?
I mean, we were just a regular family, you know, because we have four other brothers. And whereas music was my father's profession, it wasn't something that was like a household thing, like let's sit around the piano and jam all night. You know, everybody else had different things to do. My father was busy trying to work and so he could feed all of those children and stuff. And we all had our separate things that we did. So it's quite easy for me, you know, to not be interested in music.
So what happened when you were 12? Did you wake up one morning and say, I'm going to be a musician? Was it a blinding light or what?
No, then I went to school. Before this period, I was always the best one, the best trumpet player, because I was one of the only ones that even played at my age. But when I went to high school, everybody could play much better than I could. So then that was like, I said, whew. I couldn't believe how sad I was. So then I just started, I said, let me practice. You know, and I just decided to start practicing.
So you're a natural-born competitor, if not a natural-born trumpet player at that point.
Well, competitor in that, you know, it's something that I want to do. You never want to be the worst one. It's something that you should be able to do. And then my band director used to say, he used to be like, I can't believe you're Ellis's son. That's my father. I was so sad. They would just be, ugh.
And yet by the time you were 14, you were playing with the New Orleans Symphony Orchestra, weren't you?
I practiced.
So you were classically trained?
No, I wasn't really classically trained. I just studied. I became interested in classical music. But I was always listening to jazz. And you know, when you study an instrument, like the trumpet or the tuba or the trombone, you aren't trained classically. You are trained through the American, we have the band system. And that's neither classical nor jazz. That's just scales and etudes. I mean, I learned technique from playing. Yeah. Scales and most of my technique comes from jazz, listening to jazz trumpet players like Clifford Brown and Louis Armstrong and Miles Davis and Fats Navarro, because they have the most technique that I've heard.
It seems to me when I listen to you play, and I've listened to you a lot on record, that it's as if you have four separate instruments. I know it's all the same trumpet, but that is a jazz technique compared to classical technique, is it?
Well, it's a jazz performer's technique.
Yeah.
Yeah, every person is trying to get their personality across. So you do whatever you can to make the instrument sound different ways for different colors, because we just have five pieces. So we have to get as many different colors out of these five pieces together and separately as we can to invoke the proper emotional response.
Now, you do play classical trumpet, though. You're going to record the, is it the Haydn concerto?
Haydn, Hummel.
No, isn't that frustrating? Because you have to stick with the notes and the rhythm?
No, it's not frustrating at all. I mean, it's not frustrating because the music, I have respect for that music. You know, I can respect what went into that music. Mm-hmm. So when I'm playing the music, I'm not thinking of, I'm trying to play whoever's piece it is the way I feel that they would have wanted it to be played.
So then you become an interpreter of, in this case, a dead composer. Because it always strikes me that in good jazz, you're not really interpreters. You're creators and composers as you're going along together. Is that right?
Well, that's true. That's definitely true. The nature of the music is totally different. Our music has different goals, and it sets up different things than classical music does. Mm-hmm. And they shouldn't be compared. You know, each one is great in its own tradition. But compared to either one, both falter.
Well, what I feel as an audience, and what I love as an audience in a jazz club, is a feeling of going over the top, you know, going over the trenches, follow me, man. Mm. Now, the audience doesn't quite know where you're going, but there seems to be this empathy between the groups. How do you know where you're going? How do you know when you're going to change a beat?
All you can do is get the best musicians. All of the guys I have there are the best that you can get. So we just, it's a matter of...
But it's not enough to just be good, because a lot of classical musicians could never, could have the technique but not be able to sit in with you.
See, the thing, everybody overemphasizes technique in this music. You know, the music has to do with hearing and getting the music across to the people. So that's the most important thing that people understand. There are devices in this music which are set up strictly for letting the people enjoy the music. So what we're doing, what our job is to make every piece sound cohesive. So it means everybody in the band must be a soloist and an accompanist at the same time. So we set up different things, and they have to be resolved within the band. It's like a puzzle.
Do you ever get worried that because you started so young, I mean, you were with the Messengers, Art Blakey's Jazz Messengers, when you were, what, 18 or 19, that you might end young? I know it's a gloomy thought, but will you blow your heart out?
No, I don't think about that. It's too much stuff, too many other problems. I'm just worried about developing and studying, playing with my cats.
And enjoying.
Enjoying. And hoping that people enjoy.
Well, I've enjoyed talking to you today, listening to you.